few more people are yet to join, our colleagues. So yeah, that's what.
So
yeah,
if
yeah.
you want to wait, if you want to wait, no
yeah,
problem.
We'll wait for a couple of minutes. Yeah, Dr.
No
Jitendra.
Problem.
Vinay Kumar sir joined. Magda sir. Great.
Yeah, I have given wide publicity. In fact, the capacity should have been increased to 1,000.
Oh, it's okay. Thank you.
But, the quality people are there. We need only the change makers.
Okay. I know your leadership qualities. I when I was going through your bio, the last point, create leaders.
Create more leaders.
Oh my gosh, that is wonderful statement you have put. Okay. Yeah, thanks for that. Okay.
Imperative, yes.
Yeah.
The imperative to state that we are leaders.
Yes, yeah. Yeah. Thank you. And with this brief interaction among us, I'm going to start the program with a kind permission and consent by Dr. Meera, madam. Madam, I'm going to start the, okay.
Start, please.
Great to see you. Dr. Shivaprakash is joining in time. Okay. Thank you very much. Warm welcome to all of you and a very good afternoon to all my friends, colleagues, and Dean College of Fisheries. Before I start, I love to read, I love to say the National Pledge of India. This is the first time I'm doing it. India is my country and all Indians are my brothers and sisters. I love my country and I'm proud of its rich and varied heritage. I shall always strive to be worth of it. I shall give respect to my parents, my teachers, and all elders, and treat everyone with courtesy. To my country and my people, I pledge my devotion. In their well-being and prosperity alone lies my happiness. This national pledge. And India is one of the biggest and greatest democratic country on the earth. And we are proud to be born in India. It's a great country. If you listen to some of the greatest speakers from overseas, they all appreciate India. So we have to be proud for being Indians. With this national pledge, I love to welcome you all for the celebration of World Water Day 2021 with a valuing water. I love to welcome our Dean, Dr. Meera D. Ansel, for celebration of World Water Day. Thank you very much, Dr. Meera, for joining, and thank you very much.
And
the most important, and thank you very much for accepting Dr. Magda, our invitation for the invited talk. The most dynamic and leadership qualities you have, gem of a person, and you accept it, and you are going to speak on invaluable gift of nature. That's a great topic you came up within a few minutes. That's really great. We are it's really an honor to have you today. Thank you very much for joining.
Thank you.
And I'd love to welcome Dr. Vanit Inder Kaur, Head Department of Aquatic Environment. And I love to welcome Dr. Shivaprakash, former Director of Extension Education and former Dean College of Fisheries, Mangalore. And we also have Dr. A.T. Ramachandra Naik, Professor, Department of Aquatic Environment. And my colleague and friend, Dr. Manjappa, who we all worked in Bangalore as Senior Research Fellows back in 2000, great we had. Thank you. And I welcome all my colleagues, my friends, for the celebration of this World Water Day. And the most important students for this on this occasion to celebrate World Water Day 2021. With this, if I forgot, and one more, sorry, I forgot, and some of the fellow members, fellow mates joined from other colleges across the country. I can see some of their names. Thank you very much for joining today. Am I audible, Dr. Magda?
Dr. Shantanu? Dr. Shantanu?
Yeah, yeah.
Hello. Dr. Shantanu, can you hear me?
I can hear, madam.
But your voice is interrupting in between.
Okay. Yeah, Dr. Jitendra, can you hear me?
Fine, sir. Yeah, now it is fine, sir. Please proceed.
Oh, okay. Sorry for the interruption. It was showing internet speed is low. I hope I am audible now. Sorry for the interruption. With this brief welcome note, I request our Dean Madam, Dr. Meera D. Ansel, to interact.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Shantanu.
Yeah.
So very good afternoon and good day to all who have joined us today to celebrate World Water Day. In fact, this day is celebrated worldwide to celebrate water itself, specifically freshwater resources. Because freshwater is the only source which is used for drinking purpose. And we know that these resources are declining day by day. So worldwide, this day is used to spread awareness among the masses that they should save this water from becoming, you can say, extinct from this earth one day. So on this, and I must say one thing, that this event has been organized under the able guidance of our worthy Vice Chancellor, Dr. Inderjit Singh Ji. And his support and guidance in this regard is acknowledged wholeheartedly. He's the man behind all the arrangements. He have motivated all the colleges of this university to organize such events. So we are very much thankful to our Vice Chancellor, sir. And I'm very much thankful to Dr. Shiva Kumar.
You are muted.
Am I audible now?
Yeah.
Okay. So I once again thanks Dr. Shiva Kumar, who is head Fisheries Research and Information Center from Karnataka Veterinary Animal and Fisheries Sciences University. He is our guest speaker today. And shortly, Dr. Shiva Prakash, former Dean, College of Fisheries, Mangalore, he will also be joining us. So College of Fisheries, Punjab conveys a sincere gratitude to both of them for agreeing to interact with us on this important day, that is World Water Day. So sir, on behalf of College of Fisheries, we are very, very thankful to you that you are with us. And I am very, very sure that your interaction with our faculty and with our students, it will be enlightening us with a vision to be more responsible towards how we can save our water resources and how we can use it more judiciously. So since our, you can say childhood, we are listening certain phrases like no water, no life, water is life, no life without water, or save water, save life, such kind of phrases we listen every day. But unfortunately, these resources are depleting with every passing day, you know. And thanks to the human-led climate change, you everybody know, and over-exploitation of these resources to fulfill the human needs. And you know, the human population is growing like anything. If we talk about the human population, the world population is around 8 billion today. And you will be surprised, out of this 8 billion people, 2.2 billion people, they have no access to safe drinking water. And can we imagine our life without drinking water? I don't think so. So it is a matter of great concern. We have to think that how we have to save our water, how we have to conserve our resources, that our future generations, they also have surplus water, not only surplus, but safe water for drinking purpose also. So we have to be very much aware and responsible to see that how we can save our surface water, how we can save our groundwater resources, and how we can use rainwater also so that we have surplus freshwater resources around us to be used for years to come. For this purpose, let us not overexploit our resources. Let us not misuse it. Let us not waste it. And let us not pollute it. So this should be the motto, that we are not supposed to overexploit any of the resources. We are not supposed to misuse them. We are not supposed to waste them. And we are not supposed to pollute them. Further, if we talk about fisheries, for fisher folks, including our fishermen and fish farmers, and not the least, the fishery professionals, water is not only life. It is our bread and butter. No water means no fishermen, no fish farmer, no fisheries, no fish, no fisheries professional. So it is most important for us to see that we have our resources conserved, that we keep on using them for food production. As you see, if we talk about fisheries, and in fisheries, if we talk about aquaculture, freshwater aquaculture is contributing a share of around 80%. So freshwater is being used for producing fish. And World Water Day is celebrated to conserve freshwater resources specifically. So we have to be very, very conscious and careful and innovative to see that how we can use water for fisheries. See, population will keep on growing. Food requirement will never reduce. We have to feed our population. We have to feed our livestock, including fisheries. So we need food. And from where this food will come? It will either come from land or water. And everybody knows that water, it constitutes around 70% of this planet, Earth. So agriculture cannot meet the food requirement of the human population and the associated livestock sector. So we will continue to produce food from land and water. But as a responsible fisheries professional, we have to see that how we can efficiently we can use water, specifically fresh water, to produce fish. So I am very glad to inform that College of Fisheries Punjab has made many efforts in the past to see that how we can minimize water use in freshwater aquaculture. I will take a few minutes and I will brief that we are working in the direction of diversification, specifically pangas catfish culture. You know, everybody knows that traditionally we are culturing carps, and now we want to diversify. Why we want to diversify specifically in Punjab? Because in Punjab, people mostly like fish that is having less intramuscular spines. This is their feeding habit. But it is the need of the time that we shift to some such species which can be cultured in fresh water, but at the same time, we can produce more fish from the same land holding. If we compare the productivity of these two species in Punjab, like carps and pangas catfish, pangas at the most, our farmers, they are producing 2 to 3 tons of fish per acre per year. But if we see pangas, they can produce up to, you can say, 8 to 10 tons of fish from the same land holding and in a lesser period of time. So I think this kind of diversification has to be taken care of, where the same water body we can use for producing almost 3 times more food. And in view of climate change, you can say, in the coming years, we have to see that how we can minimize water use and how we can enhance its, you can say, utilization efficiency. So this is one field we are working, and we have been very successful, and we are replicating this technology in the field. And our major focus is that we have to promote fisheries, keeping in mind what type of areas we are looking into, whether they are water deficient or they are water surplus. As you know, in Punjab, we have certain areas where we have surplus water, like waterlogged areas are there. They are saline also. They are not being used for any kind of agriculture activity or any other purpose they are being used. They are neither used for drinking, nor for industrial use, not for livestock, but water resources there. So we can use those water resources for aquaculture rather than freshwater aquaculture. So here also, university has done a great job in last 10 years. and we are promoting shrimp farming in our saline areas. So we have to see that how optimally we can utilize our available resources. We can very well collaborate with our southern states who can provide us shrimp seed. We can produce the shrimp and provide that stock to the processors at the same time. So this kind of collaborations are needed in the future. And most recently, we are also working on certain other technologies where we need very less water, like aquaponics. We have established a unit recently. Then BioFlock, it is getting very popular among the farming community. So we will be looking into this, how we can promote it. And then RAS, like recirculatory aquaculture system. And finally, cage culture also. We have to see that how we can utilize our natural resources for some kind of judicious use through cage culture also. So these kind of things we are promoting at, I know everybody is promoting it at national level, but we are also doing it at our college. So our main motto is to reduce water requirement and enhance water use efficiency. So it can only be achieved through promoting multiple purpose use of water, that is through recycling or through innovative technologies. And no drop of water shall go waste. So my final message is that no drop of water shall go waste, whether you want to use it for fish farming, fisheries, or some other purpose. Single use of water that can only be like drinking, cooking. I know there are many things where you can't avoid single use of water. But in our farming systems, we have to see that how we can recycle this water or how we can integrate our water use system into different type of farming systems so that no drop of water goes waste. So with this message, I welcome Dr. Shiv Kumar. And Dr. I am very much hopeful that Dr. Shiva Prakash will also be joining us.
He has joined.
Okay, he has joined. That's great. So welcome, sir, to this today's event. And I am very much sure that interacting with both of you will be very much fruitful. Our students, our faculty, they will be very much motivated and they will be having an enhanced vision to see how they can take fishery sector ahead by reducing the water requirement. And at the same time, they will find some evolvement in terms of a human being so that they can serve the society as a responsible person and make others also aware that how we can save our water resources. With these remarks, I once again thank you all and request Dr. Shantanu to proceed further, please. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much, Dr. Meera. A great message in a few minutes you provided us, and your speech on a glimpse on importance of water you started, it was very nice, and its importance in agriculture and allied sectors, it's we are very thankful for that, and particularly focused importance of water in fisheries. That was a great message, and also you highlighted our college achievements briefly and also what potentials we have in future. That was a great message, and at the end you provided as a message that no drop of water should be wasted, every drop of water should be used judiciously. One of the speakers, great speakers, I was just listening recently, it's not that we borrowed the resources from earlier people, our ancient people, it's not that, we are borrowing the way we are growing in the present condition by destroying or whatever, we are borrowing the resources of future. Actually, we are using their features, their resources. So it is our prime aim to restore the resource for the future generation. Definitely that should be done, okay? It is all because we had to do it with the support of all the people, then only we have to work together, united, we have to work together, then only it's possible. So with this, I love to welcome two more my gurus in this occasion. It is my proud privilege to have them here. One is Mr. Vinay Kumar, the one who taught biochemistry for me way back in 97-98. And one more guru, Dr. T.N. Devaraj, okay, one of the dynamic leaders who is working in KVK in Davangere, from where I am coming from. So I love to welcome them. So at the end of after Dr. Magadas and Dr. Shivaprakash speech, they will be interacting. Okay. So with this, I invite Dr. Shivakumar Magada to give his talk, and I request Dr. Jitendra to display the slide. So during that time, I will go through Dr. Magada's achievements. In the last 25 years, 1 month, he completed. Am I right, Dr. Magada? You joined on 22nd March 1995. You have to unmute.
Maybe.
Yeah.
I completed 26 years.
Oh, sorry for that. I shortened that 1 year.
Yes, 2 years as consultant in the industry.
Okay, okay. I consider only government work. Okay. Okay, this is Dr. Magada. Dr. Shivakumar Magada, Professor and Head, Fisheries Research and Information Center at COFSU. Like how we call Gadwasu here, COFSU, it was affiliated to University of Agriculture Sciences, Bangalore. COFSU stands for Karnataka Veterinary Animal and Fisheries Sciences University. The head office is in Bidar. Dr. Magada's major research work, reclamation of problematic soils through aquaculture, productivity index chart for stocking lentic water bodies, conservative agriculture in saline and alkaline soils, and studies on the effect of claw ablation on growth and survival of scampi, that is Macrobacterium rosenbergi. And he received great awards, that is the National Chanakya Award in 2015, awarded by the Public Relations Council of India, New Delhi, for his contribution towards profession, industry, and society. And Dr. Abdul Kalam Lifetime Achievement Award in 2017, awarded by Christ Foundation for his contribution in the field of science. And Environmentalist of the Year 2017, awarded by the International Foundation for Ecology and Environment. In brief, so I already told he joined University of COFSU, that is, on 22nd February 1995. And abstract of academic works of Magada, he gave 306 guest lectures, and approximately he has calculated 34,000 exact.
Yes.
Okay, sorry for that. 34,379 participants, and the sensitization programs he did 14, and 695 participants, and youth festival, one of my favorites, like Dr. Magda, 3 youth festivals and 1,100 participants in that. It's a very big CV. I straight away go to his special achievements as it is displayed on the right side, just below his photograph, COPS. It is, he established, it's a very recent one, established new research station in the name of COPS, Center for Applied Research on Problematic Soils, to take up multi-institutional collaborative research works, and established mobile soil and water laboratory. I want to say one thing he has given. If you know him, you cannot be a pessimist. That's a beautiful statement. And his visions are inclusive economic growth through resource use efficiency, and to improve the quality of life of the people and uphold the human values through science and education, and also to make one country, one data for aquatic resources. That's a wonderful idea. And to promote sustainable farming systems, and to promote aquaculture as a treatment to conserve problematic soils, and the last and the most important, to create more leaders. So that's a great statement, Dr. Magada. So with this brief introduction about Dr. Shivakumar Magada, I invite Dr. Magada to talk about water, invaluable gift of nature. Thank you, Dr. Magada, and platform is yours, and please unmute and go ahead. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Madam Meera D. Ensign, Dean College of Fisheries, Ludhiana, Dr. Shantanu Gowda, Dr. Jitendra, Dr. Naveen, many of my colleagues, my guru, Dr. Shivaprakash, my best friend, Dr. Devraj, Dr. Mr. Vinay Kumar. In fact, enough science is all humankind. I'll repeat, enough science is already known to the humankind. We just need to understand it Responsibly, if we can ask, we have all the solutions for the problem we are facing today. Friends, the global theme of World Water Day for 2021 is water, valuing water. I'm straight away contradicting with the same statement. We cannot value the water because it is invaluable gift of the nature. That's my first statement. Be it, though it is said by UNO, I contradict it because it is invaluable nature. Next slide, you will see a small video. After this, you will definitely agree with me.
You need to share.
Yes. Now you say whether it's valuable or invaluable. Some of you may not get the sound, but no issues. You can understand. Jitendra, are you seeing the entire screen?
Light? Dr. Shiv Kumar.
Yeah.
Actually, your audio is not clear.
You have to share the screen.
Audio is also not very clear.
You need to share the screen.
No,
we cannot see. Yeah, you have to share the screen.
Sharing mode only.
Jitendra, we are not able to see the screen. The screen.
Now?
No, we can hear you. Hear that music, but we are.
Are you seeing the slide now?
No, we are not seeing the slide.
Now?
No.
Wait.
Yeah. No. Not it.
Okay, do it from me. Is it coming now?
Can I do it from my side?
10 seconds.
Okay.
Is it happening?
It's not shared.
Okay, Dr. Shantanu, you please do it from your side. As a plan B, I have sent you the PPT.
Just a minute.
Dr. Shantanu?
Yeah.
You can tell sir to send the PPT to you and you can do it from here.
Yeah. Can you see?
No, I am not able to see, I don't think.
Can you see the screen now? Do you know what happened?
Okay, while they fix the technical issues, I'll be speaking. I'll be doing extempore. My dear young friends, be patient for next 40 to 45 minutes. Definitely.
Can you see now?
Be a chain maker.
No, can you see the screen now?
Yes, it is visible.
Dr. Magda?
Yes, I'm seeing.
Okay.
Okay, go to the next slide, Dr. Shantan.
Is this the one?
Play the video, yes.
Can you hear our background music?
No issues. It is, you can understand even without the music. Next slide, Dr. Shantan. Friends, it was a self-explanatory short movie. In this context, I said it's invaluable and you cannot contradict it because he chose to collect the gold instead of water and he died eventually. Anyway, it was in a dream. Drink a glass of water for next 40 minutes. Don't move away. Though we have 97.6% water, as madam said, the World Water Day was observed, commemorated only to create awareness among stakeholders on fresh water because we cannot live with saline water. And hardly we have 2.4% of fresh water. And that 2.5%, 87% of it in the ice, and we have only a liquid water of 13%, and even that 13%, 95% of the 13% is in the ground. So after all, we get less than 0.3% for human consumption. Now, if we don't use it judiciously, definitely among all 8.7 million life forms, the Homo sapien thinks that he's an intelligent, he's the intelligent animal, definitely it will end. The world will end very soon if we don't respect the water. Friends, in India, that slide is not the next slide. You go, Dr. Shantan. We have, that's the general thing. We have 8,200 kilometers of coastline, 2.02 kilometers of exclusive economic zone, 0.52 million square kilometers of continental shelf, 3.15 million hectares of reservoirs, 2.35 million hectares of ponds and lakes, 1.3 million hectares of oxbow lakes, 2 million hectares of brackish water, 0.2 million hectares of estuary, and 1.97 lakh kilometers of rivers. If you look at the vast country with 3.28 million square kilometers, India is blessed with plentiful of water, plenty of water. Though we have 140 crores of people as of now, plenty of resources. But unfortunately, just because the water is most universal common thing which is available, people don't respect it. That's what the saying, my saying goes, most common things are never regarded as wonderful. Most common things are never regarded as wonderful. Something like air, it is so abundant, we don't respect it. Water, so abundant, we don't respect it. And jovially, and seriously, I say, and my love, most common things are never regarded as wonderful. Something like air, water, and my love, it is so abundant, we don't respect it. You know, I don't have to say, you're all learned, and very difficult to push the knowledge in the higher gradient. From higher gradient to lower gradient, you can push. But you're all learned, we are sitting in the equal gradient and pushing the knowledge to the learned people. It's very difficult still. I'll try my best. Next slide, Shantan. See, water is there in the ground, ocean. But we take any organism. You take any organism out of 8.7 million organisms on the earth. Only man thinks that this earth is designed for only human beings. My dear friends, believe me, even AIDS virus, Ebola virus, coronavirus, they have the same right to live in. It is not designed for you. And take any organisms, they are also 70% water. Somehow this symmetry is maintained, 70 to 72% of water. If water is not there in you, just imagine. So that's why before you start acting on conservation strategies, first respect. Respect. Next slide. See, life form started the earth formed 4.42 billion years ago, and first life form like blue green algae appeared on the earth 4.2 billion years ago. The complete evolved animal established on the earth maybe 3.77 billion years ago. In last 6.5 lakh years, the hydrological cycle never broken. Even before that, there were mass extinctions, hydrological cycle was there, but there was no strict regime. Believe me, my friends, out of all these water bodies on the earth, only 1% evaporates from the earth and it comes back. Only 1% is creating so much of havoc. If you don't respect, this hydrological cycle never broken. That is how it is designed. And the wonderful thing about the country, the northwest monsoon, I mean, southwest monsoons, no other countries have these kind of monsoon system, which is set during the last week of May or the first week of June. Many other countries, that's why in developed countries like Europe and other Southeast Asian countries, 365 days they carry umbrella. But we know very beautifully designed country. Our country is so blessed with, and particularly Karnataka with 10 agroclimatic situation. No other state has 10 agroclimatical situation. I mean, agroclimatical zones, and even the country, India has 22 agroclimatic zones. No other country in the world has so diverse climatic agroecological situation. See, look at the, I have put it in one slide. See the oceans, iceberg, zard, cave, lake, swamp, delta. These are all the water bodies. Island, beach, swamp, marshes, bog. So plain, canal. So these water bodies were there, but because of the indiscriminate intervention of human activities, most of these resources are changing their shape. Many of the lakes may not reach the sea. So this is where we need the serious thinkers, change makers. We have 642,000 villages in the country. Out of 140 crores, we need only 642,000 responsible people. Shantanu, you become another Rajendra Kumar, a waterman of India. To your village, I'll change my village. Let us change the entire country. For now, go to the next slide. Shantanu? Go to the next slide. Okay. I'm not seeing the slide now. Something went wrong. Well, are you listening to me, Dr. Naveen? Till the screen appears on the screen. Friends, as of now, the country is producing 392 million tons of food. In last 65 years, are you listening to me? Is my voice audible, friends? Is my voice audible, Dr. Devraj? Are you seeing the screen? Okay, it is something to do with Dr. Shantan. Okay. I'll come back. I'm louder now. Yes. Something went wrong from the organizer's end. Anyway, from the R disk, I'll keep speaking. I'm good at extempore. Okay, no problem. Friends, we are producing 292 million tons of food grain. In last 65 years, food production was increased by 5 times. Fish production was increased by 15 times. Egg production was increased by 48 times. Meat production increased by 10 times. Horticultural crops increased by 9.6 times. In spite of that, though we are producing 292 million tons of food, 20 crores of people are suffering from hunger. Another 30 to 40 crores of people are suffering from hidden hunger. Now, we have all set to increase our food production by 2025. We need to increase our food production to 350 million tons. Fish production from 13.6 to 15 million tons. Vegetable again to, from 290 to 350 million tons. So everybody is talking about doubling the farmer's income, increasing the production. But if you want to see a plant to look lush green, we don't clean the leaves with a beautiful kora cloth. We don't clean the cloth, I mean plant. We need to go into the roots. India, on an average, receives 650 to 800 millimeters of rain. Coastal Karnataka receives 400 million mm rains per annum. In spite of that, two districts in coastal Karnataka were considered under drought. In fact, you might have seen, observed, read about Kerala floods, Coorg floods in Karnataka. Immediately after the floods, you might have seen a severe drought in those districts and the state. Why it is so? Because of the global warming, because of the strong mismatch. Please hold on for some time. Dr. Jitendra, as a plan B, I sent him my sent my presentation to Shantanu. As plan C, I have sent you also. Please do it from your side. Okay. This severe drought after flood, that was because of the changing gradient of temperature. Earlier, taking the Bangalore's example, best example, it is the coolest part of the state. The higher temperature was 32. The minimum temperature we witnessed was 18 to 20 for many years. Because of so many anthropogenic activities, now the Bangalore's maximum temperature has gone up to 40. Minimum has reached 12. Because of this temperature gradient, soil moisture is gone. People have not noticed, it's not just rain or groundwater, soil moisture is gone. Relative humidity has changed significantly. Because of this stress, crop production is decreased by 25 to 30%. So these silent changes, people are not noticing it. A small change in honeybee population, small change in relative humidity, small change in the temperature gradient, soil moisture is gone. You can see plenty of water, but plants have to spend their lot of their energy towards the maintenance. So where is the energy to grow you grains? So this is what we need to understand. Though we are from the fisheries professionals, fish never be a never been a staple food except in few states and in territories. We need to grow food. And the best example, you people are sitting in Haryana and Chandigarh, you know, five rivers are there in Punjab. In last, the industrial scale of agriculture or scientific agriculture started just 5 decades ago. And that's my favorite subject, where people have used excess water, excessive usage of nutrients, monocropping led to the development of problematic soils. The country has 157 million hectares of land, and most of it is rain-fed. So if the rain delays, if the southwest monsoon delays by 15 days, crop production will come down by 30 to 32%. And only 52 million hectares is irrigated, of which, due to the mismanagement in all command areas, 9.2 million hectares is said to be saline and alkaline, which is not fit for agriculture, low productive. Me being from the from the agriculture, though I'm from the agricultural university, I say agriculture is not profitable. If you want to make it profitable, you have to understand right cropping pattern, attaining the strategies for attaining the potential yield, and cutting down the cost of production and judicious usage of water. In Kaveri Command area, that is one of the paddy growing area where the average yield of paddy in the state is about 25 quintals. Of course, in Haryana, Punjab, it's about 38 to 40 quintals, but I'm talking about the state average. And they use 6,000 to 8,000 liters to produce 1 kg of rice. In Haryana and Punjab, they use 8,000 to 10,000 liters to produce 1 kg of paddy. If you're exporting 1 kg of paddy to Pakistan or Iran, Iraq, Israel, it means to say that we are also exporting 8,000 to 10,000 liters of water. So this is where we need to understand the water requirement of each crop. So this is what the country is thinking from converting the flood irrigation to the sprinklers, drip irrigation. In fact, most of it will be operated under the evapotranspiration. The plants also, they take whatever is necessary and rest is transpired, goes to the environment. So we are just draining the groundwater, sending it to the atmosphere, and it is coming back. Even a small change in water transpiration will make the big difference. You may receive the same rainfall, but the uneven distribution of rain makes all the difference. So coming back to the aquaculture, it's happening and we are producing 8.9 million tons of fish in freshwater resources. But there also, you are just taking the water from the natural water resources or from the groundwater, growing the crop and sending it out. But if you know how to use it again and again, now the bioflock farming system, farming technology has come, wherein only once or the entire crop period you may change once, or RAS systems. There, the usage of water is reduced significantly. If you don't consider water as a commodity, you will not understand the economics. In the spirit of promoting aquaculture, people have taken conveniently considered water as free commodity, but it is not so. You have to consider water as a commodity which can be priced. It has to be considered while calculating the economics of farming. Then you will realize the importance and the value of water. You take any other country, are you seeing slides? Are you seeing slides, friends? One of you? Yes? Okay. Okay. Look at the country with vast water resources. I told you 1.97 lakh kilometers of rivers. Many of the countries do not have so much of resources. Ganga, Brahmaputra, Mahanadi, Godavari, Krishna, all drain towards the east, and Narmada, Luni, and Indus, they flow towards the west. Which country has so much of resources? You tell me. Can you name one? Okay. See, the FAO calculated, I mean, worked out during 2006, by 2050, we need 69% of the increased calories, not the food, calories. Normally, a healthy adult requires 2,800 to 3,000 kilocalories for well-being. But country, our country is protein deficit, and the whole world is producing 9.2 trillion kilocalories per annum. Next slide, please. We are producing, and that has to be increased to 16 trillion kilocalories. Look at these anthropogenic activities because of the global warming and many other industrialization, deforestation. Look at the iceberg, which is about 800 meters iceberg in the South and North Pole. Look at the waterfall. When ice melts, it goes down as a fresh water, and it destabilizes the entire column of 800 meter glacier, and slowly it breaks down, cracks, bundles of bundles, meters of meters, kilometers together, it slides and it becomes and flows to the sea, and that's how the sea level rise is happening. And look at the right side photograph, the industry producing thermal power generation, producing the sulfur dioxide. And this is what it's altering our atmosphere. Next slide. Next. See, the Indonesia, the entire country earns more money through tourism. Look at the Indonesian water, whereas the man surfing under the dirt, the deforestation in Canada, and of course in many, many countries, this is the common sight. And dying oceans and lakes. Most, I told you, 3.15 million hectares of reservoirs and 2.35 million hectares of lakes and water, the things. In Bangalore, there were 262 lakes. Now on record, 128 lakes are there. In reality, only 28 lakes holds water. You may see, you know, we have exploited. We are producing 178 million tons of fish. And predominantly, it is from the ocean. Using all the efforts, we are emptying the ocean. 85% of the fisheries is overexploited. Think of Peruvian anchovies, cod, herring. They have collapsed. It might take 200 to 300 years to regain the original beauty. And look at the lake. One of the lakes in Coimbatore, very recently I traveled and I took the photograph. Next to my office, there is a Hebbal Lake. It's about 100 acres. 80 acres was fully covered with water acid. And you know, this aquatic plant transpires 5%, I mean, 5 times more water than any other aquatic plant. So where, and every day, 5 liters of water evaporates per square meter of area. Think of the entire 3.15 or 2.35 million hectares. 5 liters of water is evaporated per square meter. Next. Climate change is expected to negatively impact crop yields, particularly in the hungriest parts of the world. Remember the red patches and pink patch becoming red very soon. Can you act? Can you stop? Can you slow down this process? Yes, we can. Human ingenuity has all the capability to slow down this process. Next slide. Look at this. Water stress will increase in many agriculture areas by 2025 due to growing water use and higher temperatures. And northern part of the country, our country, will be severely affected. And see, look at the graph. Next. The water and energy nexus. All water services require an input of energy. Energy production accounts for 15% of the world's total water withdrawals. But most of the hydro idle projects are, you know, becoming the less productive. 90% of all electricity generation is water intensive, and 80% of the world's electricity is generated by thermal power. But when thermal power is used, definitely it will add up to the global warming, and it is a big nexus. How do you balance? Next. Society and water. Water population, I'm talking about the global population, lives in the developed countries that face water shortage due to infrastructure, weak governance. And 3 billion people lack access to drinking water. These are all very recent data. And thanks to Mr. Vishwanath, my classmate, updated these infographics. And 1/5 population lives in the area where water is physically scarce. And investing in improved water management and services, it is the prerequisite. We are all thinking about increasing the food production, but water for survival is the prerequisite for sustaining the population, human race, economic growth. Next. Look at this infograph. 6% water is used for drinking, cooking, and water, and 16% for shower and bath, and 18% toilet, and 22% for household cleaning. If you collect all those water which is used for shower, bath, and toilet, at least for non-contact purposes in apartments or large congregations, if this water can recycle, definitely that is the great contribution to the nation. I appeal to all the apartment owners, decision makers, to collect all those water and treat it and use it. Definitely it can be consumed scientifically. It is safe for drinking once it is treated, but still we have the mind blockage. Treated water cannot be consumed, will not consume. People hesitate to consume such water, but at least for non-contact purpose, we can use it. Next slide. See, look at the water requirement. In 2014, and it has increased in many folds. It was 4 trillion meter cube. Now it might have reached 6 million meter cube in 2021. Next slide. 54% of India faces high to extremely high water stress. And you people, the Gadwasa people, are sitting in the hot spot. Next. Water stress it is predicted and it is going as expected. Many times we can disprove it. We have disproved Malthusian theory, but you cannot disprove this water stress. I challenge. Let us disprove it. So what happens when water reduces? Diminished crop growth, low productivity, dust storms, reduced insect population, and vector-borne diseases, increased snake migration and bites, less power, increased utility cost, increased wildlife risk and habitat damage, wars over food and water, future threat to the humankind is not diseases, it is not war. It is sheer crush of humanity and hunger and rising food prices. This is what I said. Next. Look at this water requirement by produce. Cattle per head, we need 4,000 meter cube of water. Cattle means not just cattle drinking water. You need fodder. To grow fodder, we need so much of water. When you calculate all those water requirement, it is 4,000 meter cube per unit. And that's why the beef industry is the most the carbon emitting industry, water consuming industry. Sheep and goat, they need 5,000 meter cube. Fresh beef, 15,000 meter cube. Fresh lamb, 15. Palm oil, 2. Pulses and roots, 1 meter cube. It means to produce 1 kg of pulse, we need 1,000 liters of water. Look at the last row, you'll understand. To produce 1 kg of pulse or roots, need 1,000 liters of water. Here, amount of virtual water per foot by country in meter cube per ton. To produce 1 ton of rice, US uses 1,900 liters. China uses 1,972 liters. Look at India. I'm going by the national average. In some part, Andhra and Karnataka, they use 8,000 liters. But Indian average is 4,254 liters. Look at the chicken. What is marked in red, you look at it. I'm just giving the comparative analysis. To produce 1 kg of chicken, the US uses 2,300 liters, whereas India uses 7,000 plus liters. To produce 1 kg of milk, we need 695 liters, whereas India 1,300 liters. Can we follow the success formula of the developed countries? Yes. Remember the water when you eat. If you drink 250 ml of beer, it is as equivalent as you are consuming 75 liters of water. Wine, 120 liters. A chips bag of 200 grams, you use 35 liters of water. 40 grams of fig, if you eat it, it is as good as saying you are consuming 135 liters of water. Next slide. I said it. At present, the world is producing 9,500 trillions of energy. And by saving the food waste, by minimizing the food waste, another 1,400 trillion kilocalories can be saved. But by 2050, we need 16,000 trillion kilocalories. How do you fill those gaps? How do you attain that value? Next slide. This is what, and I'm talking about water, I'm showing you food, because responsible consumption will be the key issue, prerequisite for responsible production. Look at the food waste. This is the common sight in any of the major functions, marriages, naming ceremony, any more such unwanted show-offs. Next. What is that menu? One, menu two, menu three, menu four. You can produce with cost-effective strategy with minimal usage of water to reach 16,000 trillion kilocalories. Do we have solutions? Yes. People say RAS, bioflog, Madagascar method, Sri method of growing paddy, drip irrigation, from flood irrigation to drip irrigation. All such strategies are. Strategies are there. Next. Look at agriculture. It is responsible for greenhouse gas emission by 24%. And land mass, all land mass, ex-Antarctica, 37% of land mass used for agriculture. And water withdrawal, agriculture withdraws 70% to 80% of water. Can we reduce it? The answer is yes. Yes. If New Zealand can do it, if US can do it, if Israel can do it, we can also do it, because the principles of science remain the same. Right? Next. Two slides. So this is what? For 10 billion people by 2050, we need 56% of more food. By reducing the water usage, by reducing the carbon footprint. Next. Okay, anyway, aquaculture is growing. That's what I wanted to say. But aquaculture, if China can produce 40 tons per hectare, why we are stuck at 4 to 6 tons? I've seen in my own eyes, in IPRS system, they're producing 150 kg per meter cube. If they can attain, we can also attain. This is where we can reduce the water requirement even in aquaculture. Next. Major water quality monitoring system. We need to monitor water quality. Hydrometeorological monitoring, so that we can precisely predict monsoon, relative humidity, groundwater temperature, ground moisture, wastewater monitoring. There is no term called waste. I can only say unused. wastewater, the term wastewater has to be removed from the dictionary. Drinking water monitoring, coastal water monitoring. Next. And treatment methods, anyway, we know it, clarification, filtration, carbon absorption. I don't go into the detail. Next, please. See, look at the beaches and the usage of plastic has increased significantly. If we don't dispose it responsibly, this how we lose the coast, this how we block all our drainages, and we block all our water management system. Next. Have you seen a Chappal beach? Coral beach you have seen? White beach, blue beach. This is what the common sight. And the plastic, in many of the places, the dump plastic is blocking the seepage of water. If you want to recharge the groundwater, the plastic layer has formed over 5 decades, 6 decades, and they're blocking the water seepage into the ground. So how do you draw the water from when there is no groundwater? Because 97% of the fresh water is in the ground. Next. I see a beautiful picture from Australia posted by Mr. Vinay Kumar in one of the social media. I copied. Good to be copied. If you can do this, we can save a lot of water getting contaminated. Simple thing. Having a septic tank, filters, slow sand filters, or silt traps, or collection of the major waste through using mesh can save a lot of water. Next. So what you can do, few slides from now, or another 2 minutes, I'm closing my talk. What you can do, put your knowledge into action. Don't waste water. Don't think that you cannot change. Out of 7.8 billions of people, one can change. One, think of Ambedkar, think of Gandhi, think of Martin Luther King Jr. We can change. Put your knowledge into action. Support the right politicians and lawmakers. Don't be shy away from the politics. That is what is important to make all changes in the nation. Support the right politician and lawmakers. Speak up in your community. I am doing it. You do it. Follow the rules and regulations given by the competent authorities. Use of public transport, carpooling, cycling, walking. Reduce, recycle, reuse, and refuse the plastic. Use of energy efficient gadgets. I always say, for efficient working, you need temperature ranging between 24 to 26 degrees Celsius. But earlier, the air conditions, the lower temperature was 16. We don't require that. So that is what production of electric, energy efficient gadgets. Plant trees, lots of trees on your birthday, on your anniversary. Any function, plant a tree. Put a details, collect the details of the tree, make a QR code, label it in your name, grow more trees in your campus. Use of renewable energy resources. If you believe in prayer, pray the people will find the strength to change. Next. If you just replace a coffee, a cup per day, you are saving 10,950 gallons per year. If you replace the milk with beer, I'm sorry, this is not for the students. It is prepared for the US people. They drink a lot of beer. You are saving 15,000 plus gallons of water. Replacing high flow to low flow showers, you are saving 9,000 plus more. If you replace orange juice with plain water, you are saving 16,000 gallons of water per year. If you replace beef with chicken, you are saving 69,000 plus gallons of water. Likewise, many, many examples. Next slide. People are doing it under corporate social responsibility. People are trying to rejuvenate the lakes, but only engineering science is there. They have removed all the humus that was collected for 5 decades and burned it and stone pitched. We need aquatic fish by 10 to 20%. So that's what aquatic biologists have to play a big role in reclamation, rejuvenation of lakes. People are doing it without understanding the science. They're killing the lake. Next. So now, I think this is the last but one slide. If you want to change, set a goal with 7 ingredients. You should have a clear vision. You should have a clear values, right strategies, resources. Acquire resources, acquire capabilities, acquire motivation. You motivate and take the feedback and go for change. If you don't have one ingredient, if you don't have vision and have all those, if you don't have vision and have other, next. You'll confuse. If you don't have values, you'll be corrupt. If you don't have strategy, you'll be diffused. If you don't have resources, you'll be frustrated. If you don't have capability, you'll be fatigued. If you don't have motivation, you will crawl. Martin Luther King once said, if you cannot fly, you run. If you cannot run, you walk. If you cannot walk, you crawl. But don't stop, my dear friends. Keep moving, keep moving. If you don't take the feedback, you will doubt. Please take the feedback. You must know what the society is thinking, what the people are thinking about. You have to convince at least 51% of the people that you are right. Next slide. And it's in your hand to make our country green. And next slide. Look at this dung beetle. Very interesting. It can carry 1,100 times more weight compared to its body weight. It is as succulent an adult carrying 6 double-decker buses. So when it can change, don't you think a learned man, learned people, we cannot change? Definitely we can change it. Thank you, Dr. Meera D. Ansal. Nick, go to the next slide. I thank all my friends, my chancellor, my vice chancellor, my director of research, my director of extension, and the dean, and my close friend, Mr. Vishwanath, and Shantanu for inviting me, and all those who are watching this session. I congratulate you, College of Fisheries, for organizing this one. One can change, we can change. Let us work together and bring change in our micro society. And with, if you are contentful and committed, definitely that micro society will expand and bring a significant sea change in the country. Thank you very much. Thank you, friends. If you know me, you can't be a pessimist. Thank you very much.
Oh. Thank you very much, Dr. Magadha, sir. It was a great talk. And at this stage, I'm really, really sorry for the inconvenience caused in between. Hope I am audible. Am I audible?
Yes.
Sorry for the inconvenience caused in between due to some internet problem. It was a great talk. Anyway, I have seen your presentations earlier. You're a great orator, and we all need your blessings. And a great information about importance of water. And I request if any participants and my gurus, any for interaction and discussion, you are most welcome. We'll take a couple of minutes for interaction. Dr. Devraj sir, Dr. Meera, Dr. Shivaprakash, Dr. Vinay, please interact for a couple of minutes.
Absolutely a fantastic talk, Dr. Magadha ji. as always, and your presentations keep improving and keep motivating us, and really an enlightening one. And I also take this opportunity to thank Shantanu, who is my close friend, and also Naveen, who are doing fantastic job in Gadwasu. Congratulations on organizing this beautiful webinar. And information shared by Dr. Magdaji is absolutely invaluable. And in the next 4 years, by 2025, half of the population in the world is going to be living in water-stressed areas. That is what UN has said. And that's not a happy news. And a lot of responsibilities lie ahead of us. And definitely each one of us, every individual in the society needs to contribute. And as Magdaji was mentioning, we can always, you know, depending on our available time and energy, we can opt for whatever choice. It could be a crawl, a run, or a walk. You know, anything can be done, and beautifully put it in his slide. And certainly every one of us has a role to play. And as we need water, all of us need water. Hence, we have a responsibility. I'll stop here and thank you for the opportunity.
Oh, thank you very much, Dr. Devaraj, sir. It was a wonderful interaction and wonderful opinion. Thank you very much. If anybody has, you are feel welcome. Please feel free to interact. Thank you very much. And meanwhile, I request one of our students, Prabhdayal Singh. He's going for his poem. He's going to recite his poem about water. Prabhdayal, are you ready? Yeah. Ever ready, the most, you know, active student. Is it in Punjabi poetry?
Yes, yes, sir.
Oh,
yes.
That's great. Those who cannot understand Punjabi, sincere apologies for that. He's a great orator and he writes his own poems.
Yes. Okay.
Yeah. With that, I request Prabhdayal to go ahead with the recitation of the poem. It's about water. Okay. Thank you, Prabhdayal. Go ahead.
Thank you. Thanks, sir. Sat Sri Akal, respected Dean Ma'am, respected teachers. ਸਾਨੂੰ ਫਿਸ਼ਰੀ ਸਟੂਡੈਂਟ ਹੋਣ ਦੇ ਨਾਮ ਤੇ ਪਾਣੀ ਬਾਰੇ ਸਿਰਫ ਅੱਜ ਦਾ ਦਿਨ ਨਹੀਂ, ਹਰ ਦਿਨ ਸੁਚੇਤ ਰਹਿਣਾ ਚਾਹੀਦਾ, ਕਿਉਂਕਿ ਪਾਣੀ ਸਿਰਫ ਅਸੀਂ ਪੀਣ ਲਈ ਨਹੀਂ, ਸਾਡੀ ਤਾਂ ਰੋਜ਼ੀ ਰੋਟੀ ਵੀ ਪਾਣੀ ਆ, ਸਾਡਾ ਧਨ ਵੀ ਪਾਣੀ ਆ। ਸੋ ਇਸ ਪਾਣੀ ਦੇ ਸੰਕਟ ਦੇ ਇੱਕ ਛੋਟੀ ਜਿਹੀ ਰਚਨਾ। ਸ਼ਾਂਤ ਸਮੁੰਦਰਾਂ ਤੋਂ ਕਰ ਸਫ਼ਰ ਸ਼ੁਰੂ, ਸ਼ਾਂਤ ਸਮੁੰਦਰਾਂ ਤੋਂ ਕਰ ਸਫ਼ਰ ਸ਼ੁਰੂ, ਉੱਚੇ ਅਸਮਾਨਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਛੋਹ ਕੇ, ਸ਼ਾਂਤ ਸਮੁੰਦਰਾਂ ਤੋਂ ਕਰ ਸਫ਼ਰ ਸ਼ੁਰੂ, ਉੱਚੇ ਅਸਮਾਨਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਛੋਹ ਕੇ, ਲੱਖਾਂ ਪਰਬਤਾਂ ਤੋਂ ਪਾਰ, ਪੈਂਡਾ ਨਦੀਆਂ ਦਾ ਸਰ ਕਰਕੇ, ਤੇਰੇ ਤੱਕ ਆਈ ਹਾਂ ਮੈਂ, ਨਿੱਕੀ ਬੂੰਦ ਨਹੀਂ, ਬਹੁਤ ਖਾਸ ਹਾਂ ਮੈਂ, ਸੰਭਾਲ ਲੈ ਅਜੇ ਵੀ ਬੰਦਿਆ, ਤੇਰੀ ਪਿਆਸ ਹਾਂ ਮੈਂ। ਕੋਈ ਮੈਨੂੰ ਨਿਰਮਲ ਆਖੇ, ਕੋਈ ਮੈਨੂੰ ਨਿਰਮਲ ਆਖੇ, ਕੋਈ ਕਹਿ ਦੇਵਤਾ ਬੁਲਾਵੇ, ਅਣਮੁੱਲੀ ਨੂੰ ਤੂੰ ਬੇਮੁੱਲੀ ਸਮਝਰ ਲਾਵੇਂ, ਆਪਣੇ ਹੱਥੀਂ ਆਪ ਤੂੰ ਮੇਰੇ ਜਿਸਮ 'ਚ ਜ਼ਹਿਰ ਮਿਲਾਵੇਂ, ਨਾ ਕਰ ਬੇਸਮਝੀਆਂ ਆਉਣ ਵਾਲਿਆਂ ਲਈ ਵੀ ਇੱਕ ਆਸ ਹਾਂ ਮੈਂ, ਸੰਭਾਲ ਲੈ ਹਲੇ ਵੀ ਬੰਦਿਆ ਤੇਰੀ ਪਿਆਸ ਹਾਂ ਮੈਂ, ਸੰਭਾਲ ਲੈ ਅਜੇ ਵੀ ਬੰਦਿਆ ਤੇਰੀ ਪਿਆਸ ਹਾਂ ਮੈਂ। ਪਵਨ ਗੁਰੂ ਪਾਣੀ ਪਿਤਾ, ਪਵਨ ਗੁਰੂ ਪਾਣੀ ਪਿਤਾ, ਕਹਿ ਗਈ ਗੁਰਾਂ ਦੀ ਬਾਣੀ, ਸਭ ਕੁਝ ਜਾਣਦਿਆਂ ਵੀ ਤੂੰ ਕਦਰ ਨਾ ਜਾਣੀ, ਧਰਤੀ ਥੱਲੇ ਸੀ ਜੋ ਪਾਣੀ, ਉਸਦੀ ਤਾਂ ਹੋ ਗਈ ਖਤਮ ਕਹਾਣੀ, ਧਰਤੀ ਥੱਲੇ ਸੀ ਜੋ ਪਾਣੀ, ਉਸਦੀ ਤਾਂ ਹੋ ਗਈ ਖਤਮ ਕਹਾਣੀ, ਬਚੇ ਜੋ ਤੇਰੇ ਖੇਤਾਂ ਦੇ ਪੁੱਤ, ਸਤਲੁਜ ਰਾਵੀ ਤੇ ਬਿਆਸ ਹਾਂ ਮੈਂ, ਸੰਭਾਲ ਲੈ ਅਜੇ ਵੀ ਬੰਦਿਆ ਤੇਰੀ ਪਿਆਸ ਹਾਂ ਮੈਂ, ਸੰਭਾਲ ਲੈ ਅਜੇ ਵੀ ਬੰਦਿਆ ਤੇਰੀ ਪਿਆਸ ਹਾਂ ਮੈਂ।
Thank you very much, Prabhdayal. It was beautiful. Both Tannawad, okay, in Punjabi. Both Tannawad, okay.
Shukriya, sir. Tannawad.
Yeah, thank you very much. And for kind information for my gurus, teachers, he's a postgraduate student. He's a second year, okay. He writes beautiful poems and recites as well, and he won many awards for that. Okay, so we are really, really blessed to have such kind of students in our college. We are grateful to Prabhudaya on behalf of everybody, on behalf of all the participants, my dean and my gurus. Thank you very much, Prabhudaya. Thank you very much and keep it up. And with that, I'm going to Dr. Shivaprakash SM, former Dean College of Fisheries and former Director of Extension Education, COFSU. I requested Dr. Shivaprakash, sir, as a guest for today, okay? He's also one of the greatest writers, particularly poems. And not only writing, not only putting down whatever your thoughts comes in your mind, but the way you recite, that is one of the talents Dr. Shivaprakash has, okay? With that brief introduction about Dr. Shivaprakash, I welcome, sir, for a brief talk about water, okay? And before you complete, I am going to request afterwards, I personally, okay? Thank you very much. We have to share that for the audience here. And with that, please go ahead. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Shantan Gaud. Am I audible?
Yes, you are audible.
Okay, fine. At the outset, Sasri Akal, good afternoon. I would like to pay respect to the Dean of College of Fisheries, Ludhiana, Professor Meera Madam, and our students over there, Naveen, Jitendra, and Prabhjit Singh. I know him very well, and some of you are very close to me. Friends, at the outset, I would like to narrate you what is big in this world. One poet says, the mountain is supposed to be very big to our eye, but bigger than mountain is our ocean. And bigger than the ocean is the sky. And bigger than the sky is the Almighty God. But if at all there is anything bigger than God, it is the human desire, human greed. How beautifully put. It is so huge. Human desires and greed is so huge that it can destroy nature. Friends, all that I would like to drive home the point is that water is precious, no doubt. Dr. Magda has rightly said it is invaluable. We cannot value water. Indeed, a wealthy merchant from Gulf, when he is thirsty, he may have a bag full of jewels, but you ask him, what would you like to prefer, this bag full of jewels or a cup of water, drinking water? He will say, I badly need water. I don't want jewels. That shows the value of water. There are a couple of, nearly one dozen countries in the world where water is highly scarce. Friends, we Indians are blessed a lot. Ask me why. Yesterday was World Forest Day, and today is World Water Day, and tomorrow is World Meteorology Day. And I find a wonderful link among these three. If there is forest, we will have rains. And to have rains, meteorological conditions should be ideal for rain to fall. Friends, just look at, we Indians are blessed a lot, I said. Why, you know? We have this seasonal monsoon systems in our country, which no other country in the world has. As a result, from June, July, August, September, 4 months of copious rainfall, southwest monsoon. And from October, November, December, January, we have northeast monsoon. Because of these monsoon systems, our farmers are very happy. They can raise crops, provided if there is no drought. Friends, all that I would like to highlight is that our meteorology, we had a meteorology course during BFSC, and our meteorology professor had told us, look, rain clouds fly at a height of 2000 feet. And when the monsoon sets in, the rain clouds, they flow in the sky at a height of 2,000 feet. And when they near the Western Ghats, which stretches from Kanyakumari to Gujarat, parallel to the coast, west coast, these clouds, they get trapped because Western Ghats is 2,000 to 3,000, 4,000 feet height. The tallest one is Doddabettu in near Ooty. So what I am trying to say is, these clouds, which are found at a height of 2,000 feet, get trapped because of Western Ghats, and we receive copious rainfall in the coastal area. Whatever clouds escape further into hinterland, the rainfall will occur. And imagine, Western Ghats is full of greenery. Because of the greenery, we get ideal conditions for rainfall to occur. Whereas in the hinterland, not many areas are congenial to have rainfall because there is no greenery at all. So dry, so scanty rainfall occurs. Nevertheless, we have this promise from rain god that come June, I will be arriving at your doorstep. So having said that, friends, these rainwater harvesting system that we have today because of the awareness that we have created is giving us assurance that water is going to be around us. We need to adopt rainwater harvesting systems. And I would like to quote a wonderful example. You know, Nobel laureate Switzer has said, do you say that example is the main thing that influences? No, it is the only thing that influences. We need to have an example of rainwater harvesting system so that it will trigger interest and passion among those who observe it, and they would like to emulate that. So in this direction, I would like to highlight the village called Hivre Bazar in Ahmednagar district of Maharashtra. It's a small village of only 223 families, a total of 1,300 people. The population is only 1,300 in that village. But the curse to that village is that it receives only 30 to 400 millimeter rainfall, as against in Mangalore, what we get 350 to 400 centimeter rainfall. So in some areas where it is a seasonal drought, so very scanty rainfall, in that village, most of the farmers, they fled to cities. They went to Mumbai, Goa, they went to Ahmedabad in search of a job where they would work as the workers, and they may earn hardly 300 a day or so. But one guy called Popatrao Pawar, a young man, became the sarpanch, president of that Gram Panchayat of Hivre Bazar village in 1990. And this young man had that idea of how to bring back water to his village. You know, after a thorough study, he invites all his villagers and he explains to them, if we undertake rainwater harvesting, we can get water sufficient for us to have agriculture crops and we have animal husbandry, dairy, everything. So you believe it or not, the village which was starving for water, today this village has received the National Water Village Award. And in Maharashtra, Hivre Bazar is the richest village in the state. Ask me how it all happened. Very quickly, I would like to highlight. You know, in the village, there is a big hillock, and all the villagers, they started digging trenches, concircular trenches from top to bottom. You know, those trenches from top to bottom, innumerable trenches, and they have planted millions of plants. lakhs of plants, trees they planted. And in a matter of 8 to 10 years, the village saw water table coming up. You know, when the rainfall occurs, the water doesn't flow down at speed and vanishes. No. Now, because of these trenches, first concircular trench gets filled and it overflows. Then second concircular trench gets filled and it overflows like this till the water reaches bottom. During this process, water gets percolated into the mountain. And all the trees they had planted, they started blossoming and they grew very fast. And in about 8 years or so, the mountain was full of greenery. And the water table, which used to be 50, 60 feet, 100 feet, then became only 15 feet, 15 feet. So water table came up. Once, when due to watershed planning, when water level came up, the villagers started growing agriculture crops 4 times in a year. And their less than 1,000 liters of milk production became few thousands of liters of milk production. Dairy flourished. And in order to support dairy, they could grow fodder all around, and the village became prosperous. All those villagers who had fled to cities in search of jobs, they all returned to the village. And today, the village is flourishing with happiness, prosperity, and sufficient water. This I would like to highlight to just to bring to the notice of our students. Friends, at the outset, in the end, I just would like to quote few lines of my poem on man and environment. It goes like this. In order to make life on earth safer, we must set right our home on earth in order. Accelerate efforts to make it greener, decelerate the mad rush to abuse nature. Reduce greenhouse gas emissions to cool it further, use renewable energy sources to prevent the imminent disaster. Hold on to the traditional wisdom to make life happier, lest we might prove that we don't deserve to live on earth any longer. Thank you very much for the opportunity.
Oh, thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much for being with us today as a guest. And thank you very much for sharing information and stories and a beautiful poem. Okay. Thank you. And that was lovely. And before we move, I request Dr. Rajinder and Dr. Jitendra to go for an award ceremony. We did conduct one photography competition related to the World Water Day. While they are preparing the slides and all, I request Dr. Shivaprakash to share one kind of message about I recently heard during one of your presentations about personality development, something like that. Bertrand Russell, I guess. Pass it on, pass it on, pass it on. If you could share that pass it on, we would be grateful for that. Yeah, Dr. Jendra, please get ready.
We'll pass it on.
Yeah, we'll pass it on, yeah.
Okay, friends, on the request of Dr. Shantan Gowda, I would like to narrate in 2 minutes. The story, which is 5 minutes. Okay, friends. Bertrand Russell, we all know, very famous American philosopher who lived 100 years back. And he lived for 100 years. That's another important thing. That shows a man with vision and a man with a balanced mind, a philosopher, can live longer with good health. Okay, the incident goes like this. Once when he was walking on the streets of New York, he happened to meet one of his chedidos, his childhood friend, Peter. The moment he saw Peter, oh, hello, Peter, how are you? Oh, Bertrand Russell, it is after so many years I am meeting you. I am so happy to meet you. How are you? So they had pleasantries. And then the Peter, he asked Bertrand Russell one question. Russell, I am in trouble. Can you please help me? What's the problem? No, I am in financial penury. I have no money left to sustain my life. Can you please advance me $50 that will help me to overcome my crisis? Bertrand Russell, he gave a deep thought to it and came up with a solution. And he said, okay, friend, I'll give you $50, but under one condition, that you should not give it back to me. You should hand over to someone who is in similar trouble like you and put the same condition to him that he should not give that money back to you. He should pass it on to someone in such distress. This way, I want this $50 to keep changing hands from one hand to the other. And then he was so happy with his thoughtful process, thoughtful idea. And he agreed, and then he gave him $50 and he went away. And that evening, our friend Bertrand Russell, he goes and meets his another friend, Henry Burton, a famous poet. When he explained to him, this thing happened in the morning, I met this such and such a story, he said, oh my God, what a noble thought has flashed to you. I find it most useful message you have sent to the society, sent to the world. And he instantly composes a poem. And Henry Burton composes a poem. The poem goes like this. It is not given for thee alone. Pass it on, pass it on. Let it travel down the years. Let it wipe another's tears. Pass it on, pass it on. Have you heard the singing bird? Have you heard the sweet word like the singing of a bird? Pass it on, pass it on. So that way, we should help people who are in distress. And if you cannot part with your money when you are wealthy, it is no life worth living. So this is the message I just want to convey. Thank you very much, Santhangaur.
Yeah, thank you very much. Let the things pass it on to other people. And don't expect returns from those people who, you know, get the benefit. Let them pass it to other people. That's a beautiful message. And I hope, thank you very much, sir. And I hope Dr. Jitendra and Dr. Rajinder are ready with the presentation. We did conduct, they are going to speak about that. Okay.
Dr. Shantanu? Dr. Shantanu?
Yes.
Hello?
Yes, yes.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear. Yeah.
Okay. Before you start with the presentation, can I say a few words?
Oh, sure. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Dr. Shantanu. I just want to thank Dr. Shiv Kumar and Dr. Shiva Prakash. Thank you so much, sir, for sharing such a wonderful presentation and talk with us. And the most important and interesting part was that you have quoted many examples. And after seeing that presentation, although we had some internet issues, but I can make out that you had presented a very well draft, you can say, story. And our students, it will be a learning experience for them. And thank you so much, both of you, for motivating us with the positivity and responsibility to take care of our water resources. Thank you so much, sir.
Madam, thank you very much. Very recently,
yes.
Maybe 90 days ago, 23rd November, Dr. Shantanagoda visited our campus.
Okay.
During that time, because that presentation was not there. Unedited presentation.
Magadha, be a little louder, please.
Okay. During November, Dr. Shantanagoda visited our recitation. Then we invited one of the experts from IIT Mumbai and many other BMMP officials, and we discussed about water treatment of domestic sewage in Bangalore. And very recently, in collaboration with Department of Fisheries, we motivated and in fact, they themselves cleaned about 100 acres Ebal Lake, and the weed was infested in an area of 80%. They removed the weed, and now the Ebal Lake, you just see in the internet, it looks so clean. They removed the weeds in about 80 acres. Now it's about 2,000 to 3,000 tons of wheat they have removed. So now we are in decision makers, NFDB and BBMP, Bangalore Mahanagar Palike, to buy such weed harvesters to clean the lakes. Let us work together to create at least awareness among the people on management of natural water bodies.
Yes, sir. We will be very happy to collaborate for this. I would like to add something in this direction. Recently, IIT Ropat, they have also contacted us. They want to use nanobubble technology for remediation of our village ponds. As you know, in our state, we have around 12,000 of villages with at least one pond in every village. And you know very well, all these ponds, they are polluted with the domestic sewage, other things coming from the adjacent agriculture fields and all that. But at the end of the day, they are a very rich source which can be utilized for many other activities, including aquaculture also. So we have to see that how these resources can be utilized for aquaculture. So we are collaborating with IIT people to see how we can treat these water bodies using nanobubble generators. So certainly, sir, we will be working together. We will make a plan and see that how we can use these people in, you can say, in conservation of our water bodies. Yes.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you. That was a wonderful interaction. Okay, great interaction. Thank you. And Dr. Jitendra, over to you now. Dr. Jitendra and Dr. Rajinder.
Yes, sir. I'm just sharing that.
Yeah, sure. Thanks. Go ahead.
Yes, sir. Sir, in this online competition that was on the occasion of World Water Day with the theme Valuing Water, Judicious and Efficient Use, we have received a total of 21 entries from the students of Gudvasu. And in this online competition, they have tried their best to very well fit into the theme. And in this, the participation from all the students, it is very much acknowledged as they have put their efforts into this event. And the evaluation of this program, online competition, photography competition, it was based on the clarity, relevance to the theme, and how fine the message they have conveyed. So in this online photography competition, the third position, it is backed by Mr. Anupam, who is a student of College of Fisheries, BFSC third year. So in his photographs, he through his pictures, he has tried. So through the pictures, he has tried to convey the message that how water, it is important as the water at the plant who is growing in water, it is having very much bright colors, whereas the one which is without water, that is very dull and it's not in a good condition. So in this picture, he has tried to convey the importance of water that is very much essential, not only for plants, but for every living organisms. In his other pictures, so he has tried to convey the comparison that is in the plant with this without water and with water. So in the pictures, he has clarified the importance of water in the life of all the living beings. Whereas in the next pictures, the third prize, it is shared by two students. One is Mr. Anupam. Whereas the second prize, the second position in the same prize, it is backed by another student. So the PPT it is not showing.
Rajinder, you can just go ahead with that announcement because he has lost the power there in his place. Sorry for the inconvenience.
Okay, no issue, sir. Okay. Yeah. So the third prize, it is shared by the two students. First one, it was Mr. Anupam. And the next participant who has got the same position of third, she is Ms. Amanat Kaur, who is again the student of College of Fisheries, a first year student. So in the pictures, she has shown the water that a single drop, even it is the water that is leakage, whether it is from irrigation or any other purpose we are using. So the drops that are being considered as wastage for us, but the single drop along with the others, it can be a source of life and energy for the others. In the next picture, she has shown the thermal plant, which is in around that, there is a water reservoir along with that thermal plant. So that water reservoir, it is absorbing the heat energy of that plant. Along with that, it is serving as a source of life for the aquatic organisms that are being cultured in that reservoir. Activities for the human beings. So water, it is very much essential for living beings, the survival, and it can along same time, it can also be used for the recreational activities. So the third prize, it was backed by two students, Mr. Anupam and Ms. Amanat Kaur, both are the students of College of Fisheries. So to Ms. Upinderjeet Kaur, she is the student of College of Dairy Science and Technology, Gidwasu. In her pictures, she has shown the comparison of how water is always more valuable than the money. We can't compare money, water with the money. No doubt we can buy anything with money, but if a person who is thriving for water, he or she will need only water. So water, it is a priceless entity. We can't compare its value with any price value. So in that, she has shown that. In the next picture, she has shown that till that a living being or any organism, living organism, they needs water, and the small efforts, even the small efforts of a person can help in saving water and life. And also each one of us can make efforts for the saving of water. So these were the pictures of Ms. Amanat Kaur, who has bagged third position. The second one, goes to the Miss Upinderjeet Kaur. Next, the first prize of this photography competition, it goes to Miss Manu Shukla, who is a student of Dairy College, College of Dairy Science and Technology. In her pictures, she has shown how judiciously or efficiently we can use water. No drop of water, it can be considered as waste. In her pictures, she has shown that the wastewater that we consider from the outlet of our water purification systems, that can also be used for the watering of our plants that we have either grown in our home or in our outside areas. In the next pictures, she has shown that the most common mistake that we people generally do is we keep the tap on while brushing. So by keeping these small things into our mind, we can save water, and so that we can keep it safe for our future generation also. So these were the results of our online photography competition. So congratulations to all the participants and the winners also. Then next. Yes, sir.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Over to you, sir. Yes.
Yeah, thank you very much for a lovely presentation. Hearty congratulations to all the winners, and most importantly, congratulations to all the participants, because participation is very, very important. Thank you very much. And now we are going for word of thanks. So again, I am going to do this one. Dr. Jitendra is off, so I'll have to do. Thank you very much. And I take this opportunity to thank the young and energetic and the dynamic dean of our college, and she is doing a lot of hard work because we have constructed a new building and moving things from old building to new building and setting up things and buying stuff. We are really highly gratitude to Dr. Meera D. Ansel for her excellent efforts for bringing the college to a supreme level. Okay, no doubt about it. She is doing a lot of efforts, and meanwhile, conducting these kind of activities needs extra energy. Okay, so on behalf of all the participants and speakers and students, I thank you, Dr. Meera D. Ansel. And the next, I thank you very much for accepting our kind invitation in the last minute, Dr. Shivakumar Mugda. Okay, for accepting the invitation and presenting a nice talk and giving a lot of information. And also indirectly, I thank Dr. Vishwanath, who has helped you for bringing a lot of data in an organized manner. Am I right? You articulated, and particularly bringing that video clipping in the very beginning, that was really awesome. Okay, thank you very much. On behalf of all the participants and my gurus and Dr. Meera, Dr. Shivaprakash, thank you very much.
You used a very good adjective when you were addressing the dean. You said young. I'm the youngest.
Okay. Okay, right. Good. Thanks, Dr. Magda. And I'd love to thank Dr. Shivaprakash, sir, for accepting invitation. I told briefly, sir, your talk should be very brief. In a brief speech, you highlighted many things, stories, poetry, poems, and messages. And thank you very much on behalf of everybody. Thank you. Thank you. Okay.
Chantan God.
Yes, sir.
Just I would like to say, see, yes, we receive nearly 400 centimeter rainfall during southwest monsoon in India, right?
Yeah.
Whereas United Kingdom, Great Britain also receives same amount of rainfall, but there it occurs in 12 months throughout the year. Whereas we receive that within 4 to 5 months.
Yeah.
And that's the difference. And when I said the monsoon system exists only in India, no. When I meant India, all the neighboring countries are also the beneficiaries. Sri Lanka, yeah. Pakistan, Bangladesh, Thailand, Myanmar, all these countries bordering our seas. When I went to Malaysia some 6 to 8 years back on a tour, we went to see one golden temple. It was March month and scorching sun, very hot weather. All of a sudden it started raining. For 10-15 minutes, it rained cats and dogs. I asked one guy, we ran helter-skelter to take shelter from rain. And I asked one person, how come it rained? It was so hot. He told me, it is like that only here. It can rain at any time. That is the difference between India and the rest of the world. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir, for your presence of mind. Thank you very much. And for sharing your Malaysian experience. And at the same time, we have Dr. Devaraj, who did his PhD in University Putra, Malaysia. Okay, am I right, Dr. Devaraj? Yeah, thank you very much. It's a lovely experience. And at this stage, I also thank Dr. Vinit Indarkor, Head Department of Aquatic Environment, for our kind support. And I thank all the participants, and particularly Dr. Rajinder and Dr. Jitendra for making this event a success and organizing a photography competition. It was a bit difficult in the last minute they requested and they motivated students to participate. They participated, it was really good. And I thank you all. And if I have missed anybody, and my sincere apologies for that.
Dr. Shantanu.
Yes, madam.
Yes, you have missed someone that I will complete, okay. So I congratulate the organizing team that includes Dr. Shantanu, Dr. Jitendra, Dr. Rajinder, and Naveen. Yeah. So you have made a commendable job, you know, okay. So you have told that the College of Fisheries Punjab is transforming, you can say, from its old building and transferring into the new building. I would like to say that it is not possible without my faculty, which is very young and energetic. So thank you all of you for supporting me. With your support only, I am able to do all these things. So congratulations once again for organizing such a lovely event today. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Thank you. And on behalf of College of Fisheries, Punjab, Ludhiana, I request Dr. Magda, Dr. Shivaprakash, Dr. Devaraj, and Dr. Ramachandran, he just left. We request and we invite you to College of Fisheries, Ludhiana, in near soon, okay? Dr. Vinay as well, okay? Thank you very much. It was a lovely, lovely day. So we have to be honest, this morning when I went for brush, that photography came to my mind. So this is kind of, you know, you have to create awareness. though we save a lot, drop of water, but somewhere it will be useful for somebody else. No doubt about it, okay? Thank you very much. A wonderful day. So not willing to leave this meeting.
No plastic in my office.
Oh, that's great. Thank you very much. Okay, with that, can we conclude?
No tissue paper in my office, only handkerchief.
Okay, that's great, sir.
Please practice it. Please practice.
I am sitting at KVK, Mangalore. Oh. I have.
You must thank Dr. T.J. Ramesh also.
Yeah, T.J. Ramesh, I should thank him. Yeah, definitely. You sat there for 3 years.
Okay, thank you very much. And with that, can we conclude the celebration? Yeah, Dr. Jitendra, please.
Fantastic, Shantanu.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Thank you. It's all your blessings, support.
See you.
Thank you.
Okay. Yeah. See you, Dr. Magadaji, Shubhakash, sir.
Yeah, thank you.
Madam, thank you.
Everybody, yeah.
Have a good day.
Okay. Nice to see you, Devraj. Very good. Yeah.
And one more. Thank you to Dr. Harsha. Thank you to Dr. Harsha. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Dr. Devraj's wife has become registrar of Davanagere University. Congratulations.
Yeah, congratulations.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Namaste. Have a good day. Namaste.
Bye-bye. Okay, madam. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you, madam.
Isn't there a place?